I was I'm Delighted to see so many of you here today, and so glad you've come back. That's the highest compliment you can pay. And we have a very special treat for you today with a speaker who I think you will enjoy immensely. I just want to, before we start, I want to mention that I didn't bring it up here with me, but those of you who were here last week, you'll recall that Bob and not last week, but the last meetup, that Bob and I had were in the process of publishing a book, which we had hoped to have, but we didn't get it until the following week. But we do have it now. If any of you want to buy it, it's called Molecular Memories. It's a book of fun stories about the paired history and the strange relationship that Bob and I have shared. And if you were here last time, you probably saw enough to not need the book. Also, I want to mention that we do have some toys. There's a thumb drive available that is loaded with all of our podcasts. I don't recall how many. Mary, how many podcasts are on here? Is it?
There are 8 and 7.
Okay, so there's like 8 podcasts and 7 webinars that were recorded. So there's some good conversation. We also have an ICRL I'm glad I'm not speaking today. This is one of these things you plug into your computer or whatever, and it gives you a whole bunch of other ports. And we are also giving a free ICRL mouse pad to anybody who buys anything. In fact, we may even give you a free mouse pad even if you don't. But in any event, we do have our selection of books back there. But, and the one other thing I will say before I forget is one of our visitors last time, pardon me, Leslie Nolan was here. She has offered to do our next meetup, which will be in January. And this is going to be on intentional creativity. Leslie is an artist, and I don't believe we've had anybody speaking on that dimension up until now. So I encourage you, this will be on Saturday, January 16th. We have some flyers here, and of course that'll be posted on our meetup and webpage. However, enough of that. I am delighted that we have with us today, all the way from Chicago, Dr. Neal Grossman, who is has been a professor of philosophy at the University of Illinois Chicago for some 40-odd years. And in particular, he is a specialist on Plato and on Spinoza. And in fact, one of the ICRL books that we published, was it a year ago? A year and a half ago, was Neal's book called The Spirit of Spinoza, Healing the Mind. It is, I speak as the editor, it's a fantastic book. If you're not familiar with Spinoza, because like me, you found it a little bit too impenetrable way back when you took it in college. This is now a much more readable version. It's so much more relevant to today than it was to Spinoza's time. In fact, Spinoza was as much of a misfit and outcast in his days as we are in ours. But it's a beautiful book, and I know because I was editing it, I ended up having to read it several times. I would caution you, if you're going to read it 5 times, be careful, because the guy gets under your skin. And once he does, you can't get rid of him, because he's always here whispering in your ear, and he's always right, damn it. In any event, it's a great book, and we are just thrilled to have Neal Grossman with us today to talk about Spinoza and one of his other areas of long-standing interest, the importance or the relevance of the near-death experience for the future of society. And I think you'll find this fascinating. Neal, welcome.
Good I am with the mic, but if I wander over like that, I'll just shout or something. I want to say a few things about the paper before I get into it. So I don't know if anyone has heard of the neuroscientist Mario Odegaard. I think that was working. Okay. Very good. He wrote some non-technical, of course. So he was asked to put together a volume of essays with on post-materialist science, with the leading contributors being people like Rupert Sheldrake, Larry Dossey, people I'm sure you've heard some of these names. And I was the only non-scientist asked to contribute to it, and so this is my contribution to that volume. It's entitled Towards a Post-Materialist Social Order, with a subtitle Back to Plato. So you get some idea where it's going. So I want to correct one thing that she said. No academic philosopher would recognize me as a scholar of Spinoza or Plato or anybody. My real background, what's called area of specialization, in graduate school was philosophy of quantum mechanics, and my doctoral dissertation was on that. The other thing I wanted to mention before getting into it was I read the first couple of chapters of their molecular synergy. And if you look at that, we talk about the atoms bogging the particle focused in the here and now, in space and time, and breaking the wave all over the place. Well, this paper will be wave-like, definitely, all over the place. So, okay, so sorry. I just want to say that 40 years, 45 years, if you're here from Princeton, I don't want to insult anybody, but I refer to being in the spiritual wasteland of academia, having gone to many, many talks. The most interesting part is always the discussion, not the talk. So let's get this talk over so we can go with a fun, interesting discussion. So it begins with a quote from Plato. He says, these are frightening men you're talking about. And then the footnote, say that quote is from the Sophist. Plato goes on to ask, he's talking about the materialists. He's referring to materialists who believe, again, a quote from Plato, that anything they cannot squeeze in their hands is absolutely nothing. Okay? So that all the qualities, love, kindness, passion, spiritual experience, you cannot squeeze these in your hand, you cannot measure them. They're absolutely nothing according to materialism. So, okay, let me start. In the past, when I taught metaphysics, I would impress upon my students that there is no connection between being a materialist and being materialistic. The former involves a belief system that asserts that all real things are constituted by matter, and whatever is not so constituted is unreal. The latter involves a psychological attitude or value system according to which the acquisition of material goods, wealth, and status motivates and defines how one lives one's life. It is quite possible, I would tell my students, to be materialist philosophically without also being materialistic with respect to the content of their lives. Many individuals who define themselves as materialists are very kind and caring human beings, not at all selfish in their personal lives, strive to make this world a better place for all, and do not worship the gods of wealth and status. I now believe that I was mistaken, not with respect to the fact that many who profess faith in materialism are altruistic in their behavior, but rather with respect to the claim that there is no connection between materialism and being materialistic. There is a connection, and it is a logical one. If, as is the case, so-called materialists are able to behave decently and even altruistically, it is in spite of their faith in materialism, not because of it. Well, here's a little aside. Materialists, of course, do not identify their beliefs as faith-based. For the materialist, it's always the other belief systems that are based on faith, not his own. A materialist is faith-based as fundamentalist religion because, one, there's no evidence that supports it, and two, much evidence has falsified it. In a reference to Kelly, he calls reducible mind. People remember that which is a grand surprise through the ages of all the evidence against materialism, supporting the thesis of the mind is not reducible to that. To believe in something that has been shown to be false requires much irrational faith, together with astounding ignorance of the empirical evidence that has demonstrated its falsity. Critics of their work remain completely ignorant of the data and empirical basis for the conclusions that they came to. This ignorance is what allows them to sustain their faith. In fact, many materialists go out of their way to avoid becoming informed of data that falsify their beliefs, in much the same way that we would expect a fundamentalist Christian to avoid acquainting yourself with the facts of geology and anthropology. 60 years ago, the British philosopher C.B. Broad, who investigated parapsychological research and took it seriously, said of his colleagues, if like most contemporary Western philosophers and scientists, I were completely ignorant of or blatantly indifferent to these phenomena, I should, like them, leave the matter there. But I do not share their ignorance, and I am not content to emulate the ostrich. Okay, so it's a combination of ignorance and denial. That's where I think the materialists are today. So his remarks are as true today as they were in his time. But getting back to our topic, the logical connection between materialism and being materialist is really quite obvious. If everything is just matter, if all we are atoms, particles in motion, then there is no possibility of accounting for the most important things in life: kindness, compassion, altruism, love, to say nothing of spiritually transformative experiences, which I'm sure some people in this room have had. For one desires to live consistently with the religion of materialism, one ought to desire and pursue only those things that the religion says are real. That is, things that are material in nature and hence can be squeezed in their hands, to cite Plato, such as wealth, possessions, and status. Those are the things you can squeeze in your hands. Whatever cannot be quantified as some sort of material good is unreal, and one ought not to waste one's time pursuing such imaginary fantasies as loving kindness. To have the goal in life to accumulate as much money as you can, as much status as you can, okay, that's fine. To have your goal in life to forgive those who have harmed you, to develop loving compassion, this is, you know, fairy tale stuff for the materialists. It's not, you can't squeeze that in your hands. However, unlike individuals, now if you know Plato, you know he's constantly going from the individual to the society, that the two mirror one another. So unlike individuals who may identify as materialists, our present capitalist social order is quite consistent with respect to being a logical consequence of materialist ideology. Only the pursuit of material goods constitutes a good life, hence the pursuit of wealth and status as the means to acquire such goods. The true materialists of our culture are not academics. Academics love argument and discussion much more than they love money, and hence do not actually live their professed value system. Right? I'm saying there's a little bit of hindrance, right? If they were really materialists, right, they'd be out chasing after money. The true materialists in our country are the Wall Street bankers and corporate executives who seek nothing but money. They are true sociopaths, and as Plato said, quite frightening indeed, as they are able to harm millions of people with any twinge of conscience. Adherence to materialist ideology explains the singular lack of compassion and loving-kindness in the institutions of our culture. From the many and varied motivating desires within the human being, from greed on the one hand, to altruism on the other. A material society like our own selects mostly for greed, which is why the economic and political aspects of society are controlled by those individuals who are motivated by greed, rather than by those who are motivated by kindness and compassion. But according to Spinoza, greed and ambition are, quote, species of madness, unquote. Think of it. Say you're insane if that's what motivates you. And to the extent that Spinoza is correct, we have allowed the world to be run by individuals who have become mad through their greed for wealth and status. In our present social order, the lunatics are running the asylum. Now, closely associated with materialist ideology and practice is another metaphysical belief system called atomism. Atomism holds that the real world is constituted by independently existing units whose interactions constitute the entire material realm of being. Putting together, you get materialist reductionism, the official religion of academia, which holds that all things, including consciousness, can be reduced to the motions of these fundamental units of matter. We noted passing in Aristotle's academia, forgive me for that. It's hard to be purely positive, especially when you spent 45 years there. We noted passing that atomism is empirically false, as the field theories of the 19th century and relativity and quantum theory of the 20th century support holes, not atoms. According to our best theories about the nature of matter, there are no fundamental units of matter, and everything is deeply interconnected with everything else, such that the entire physical universe comprises a single unbroken whole. And this is a reference to David Bohm, his word on that. Such deep inconsistency seems to have eluded the notice of academic materialist reductionists, who are wedded to a false 18th century matter, according to which the fundamental units are easily imaginable, like billiard balls or marbles, having precise spatio-temporal definition, and of course, can be squeezed in one's hands. Then I have a footnote, and I think I'll read it. Let me read this, because it adds to this. Because academic materialist reductionism, fundamentalism, as I like to call it, has been and still is so influential, I want to linger with this theme for another footnote. To believe in materialist reductionism requires that one be not only ignorant of the empirical data that shows beyond a reasonable doubt that consciousness is not produced by the brain. Ignorant of the fact that our best theory about the nature of matter, quantum mechanics, implies that atomism is false, but also be ignorant of the fact that a major interpretive strand of the quantum theory holds that the theory itself requires that consciousness exists as an independent variable. This is referred to as the problem of measurement, and you can see the writings about Newman, Wigner, and today's Stats writing along those lines. It seems to be that materialist reductionists, if they were intellectually honest, would feel some need to address the fact that our best theory about the nature of matter appears to support neither atomism nor materialism. But the fundamentalists do not feel a need to do so, any more than the creationists feel any need to address the facts of geology. This is why I said that materialist reductionists are wedded to the 18th century. However, we're all over the place. Try wandering a little bit. Although atomism applied to the material world is certainly false, the more pernicious nature of atomism occurs in Western religions and theologies, which hold that minds or souls, although not reducible to matter, are nevertheless all separate from and independent of one another. Hence the belief in all Western religions that some souls will be separated off from others and sent to hell permanently. This is a vicious belief system that allows for, condones, and even encourages the most extreme forms of cruelty and violence now in evidence all over the world. But the atomism of Western religions is contradicted by the data emerging from 130 years of empirical research. The worldview emerging from and supported by this empirical data asserts that consciousness is a fundamental existent, perhaps the fundamental existent, and also that the individual consciousness we experience ourselves as being is so intrinsically connected with other individual consciousness so as to create a single one mind. And here's a reference to Larry Dawson's book called One Mind, right? One Mind. How our individual mind is part of a greater consciousness and why it matters. This is Hay House 2014. It's a great book. If you've not read it, you'll like it. Larry Dawson is a great writer. So the world, yeah, so this is One Mind, Larry Dawson's One Mind, is also Plato's World Soul, which creates both the world and our experience of it. The term panentheism is sometimes used to describe a worldview of this type. Now, it is not my intention to, let me back up. Just one aside I meant to say at the very beginning, is that for the book for which this is an essay, Mario Borga is going to write an introductory chapter in which he lays out all the scientific evidence, or a bunch of it. And this scientific evidence, I would say, for two propositions. One, consciousness is not reducible to matter, and so hence materialism is false. I take the evidence for this to meet the criminal standards of evidence, beyond a reasonable doubt, which means that anyone who is aware of the data and the evidence and concludes otherwise is being unreasonable. And the second premise of my paper is that we're all in this together, that we're all part of a single one mind. Now, here I think the evidence is not as strong as for the belief, as for the data of false science materialism, but I think it does meet the civil status evidence, more likely than not. So I'm going to take that as the two, as the basis for what I'm going to then talk about. So now, it's not my intention here to discuss metaphysics per se, rather I wish to explore the following question. Just as rebased capitalism is a social order that follows logically from a materialist belief system, what is the new social order that follows from empirical findings that strongly suggest, one, consciousness is not created by the brain, and two, individual minds, such as our own, are intrinsically connected so as to form a single one mind, of which we are all essential components. What follows from the empirical fact, established by science beyond a reasonable doubt, that our physical brains do not create the very consciousness we experience as ourselves? If human consciousness is not self-caused, right, no one here is the cause of their own existence, so we're not self-caused, and I'm losing my place. If human consciousness is not self-caused and it's not caused by the physical brain, then what, or perhaps who, causes this consciousness to come into being, the consciousness that we experience as ourselves? So get it? Our brain does not create the consciousness we now experience as ourselves. We didn't create it. So what does? And more importantly, for the purpose of this essay, is the question, what follows from these one and two principles with regard to a possible social order that embraces and is in harmony with our emerging post-materialist science? From the fact that consciousness is not created by the brain, it follows that consciousness, that is our minds, did not begin to exist when the brain was formed. It also follows that it will not cease to exist when the brain dies. So the mind, prior to associating with a body, and becoming what we are now experiencing as our embodied selves or personalities, exists in its own right. Considerable insight into the nature of non-embodied existence may be gotten by studying the near-death experience in depth. And so I am hoping that that most of you are familiar with the phenomenon of near-death experience, but I have a lot of quotes about that book. I think make the point. These reports confirm in great detail Plato's claim that the body acts as a dammer to the mind's native intelligence. Now, who quotes with Plato? Quote, the body confuses the soul and does not allow it to acquire truth and wisdom whenever it, the soul, is associated with the body. That's one quote. Again, if we ever to have pure knowledge, we must escape from the body and observe matters in themselves, with the soul by itself. All near-death experiences with that. Where was I? So NDEers and mystics report being more awake, more conscious, more real, and more of who they really are when out of the body than when in it. This is universal across all cultures. So the embodied consciousness, the personality, that is, we as we now experience ourselves to be, is experienced as less real than the non-embodied consciousness. The embodied consciousness emanates, so to speak, from something greater than itself. I will arbitrarily use the words personality and ego to refer to the embodied consciousness, and with some reluctance use the word soul to refer to the greater reality we experience as being when not embodied. The soul is, of course, the greater of the two, and the personality is embedded in the soul, perhaps in a way similar to how the self in a dream is embedded in the mind of the dreamer. Now, if we were to ask a materialist to say something about the relationship between our present personality and the forces or causes that create the personality, the resulting story would say a lot, and does say a lot, about the development of the brain of the individual. Some combination of genetics and environment caused this present personality to come into being. Now, why am I me? Why am I like I am? Possible to describe genetics and upbringing. That's what we said. But notice, no meaning or purpose plays any role in the story. We do not choose our genetic makeup. We do not choose our upbringing, and according to the material of the story. And so the major causal factors necessary for creating the unique individual personality that we are has nothing to do with us. We are the results of processes that merely happened to us, or that merely happened to generate us. And of course, because there is no meaning or purpose to our existence, it's all just stuff, material stuff out there, the only meaning to be found in an embodied life lies in chasing after material goods. Now, the empirical data that establishes as fact that consciousness is not created by matter offers a much different response to questions pertaining to the relationship between the present personality and its cause, or causes. Using data from NDE research, especially the Life Review, see following, I think has the quotes, and the claim that the non-embodied state is realer than real, you get that from, you know, some mystics and their death experience. Two nights ago, I was very privileged to spend with Evan Alexander at his home. Most of you have heard of him. And that sense of real is just so powerful, it emanates from many years when you talk with them. So as well as data from reincarnation cases, especially the in-between state, together with data from research mediums, it appears that there is a tension and purpose underlying the lives, the personalities of each and every human being. In sharp contrast to materialism, it is not by mere accident that we are the unique individuals that we are. The soul, it appears, exercises some choice with regard to the specific individuals who are our parents, knowing in advance the environmental conditions that come with the choice of parents. So the soul intends, if you will, to manifest as us, and selects for parents and environmental conditions that will bring about its intentions. So you notice that meaning is built in, purpose is built into this way of looking at it. Okay, but why? Notice that this question cannot even be raised under a materialist worldview. The atoms and physical forces that create the body and constitute its very being have no purpose whatsoever. But if the personality is intentionally created by a consciousness that is greater than itself, and if this personality is actually a part of or embedded in the larger creating consciousness, then the questions of meaning and purpose necessarily arise. No student of the near-death experience can fail to notice, perhaps with a bit of dark humor, that many, if not most, NDEers are quite reluctant to return to their bodies and are often quite upset finding themselves or herself still a body. This is an empirical fact. Just talk to, nurses probably see this more than doctors. So why can't they stay? You've died, you're now a being of light, and he tells you, you better go back, you don't want to go back. Right? Why can't you stay when they want to stay? So why can't they stay? Why are they sent back? And to take this query to its logical extreme, why were we compelled to take on physical form in the first place? There's quite a bit of data on the first two questions. And here, people have different conceptions of what data is. I count as data what people report. One mentor is an anecdote of thousands of important incidents data. We look at similarities, differences, and so on. Statistical analysis, and all that fun stuff that Brenda likes to do. In any year, our state that they are sent back because there's more for them to do here, that it is not their time. That is, there's some purpose for which they're sent back. So our individual lives have intrinsic meaning and purpose, and it is reasonable to conclude that there is reason and purpose underlying the soul's decision to manifest as us. Now, what if anything, follows from this with regard to society as a whole? Materialism, we have said, leads quite logically to the kind of social order we have today. A social order that selects for greed and ambition, since only individuals who are so motivated have any chance of succeeding as our society defines success. That is money and reputation. That's what successful one is. Another measure of our society's true values would be the pay offered to those in the helping professions versus the pay offered to those in business and finance, professions entirely dedicated to the pursuit of greed and personal ambition. Those that have only the gambler's talent, the ability to lie with a straight face, receive the most remuneration, which actually reflects the value of this materialist culture. But if our personality is caused by our soul, or by a consciousness greater than our personality, and it is caused not randomly but intentionally, then what? Is it ever the case, we ask, that a non-embodied consciousness would create a personality or an aspect of itself with the intent that the created personality would spend its so-called life chasing after wealth and status? And here's where I get carried away, so I apologize. Of what use are such things to the soul? For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? The man, the embodied consciousness, cannot, of course, lose the soul of which he is a part, but he can lose a sense of connectedness with the larger consciousness that is manifested as his human form, and can come to believe that he's only the human form, and come to value only what aggrandizes the form, and forget the values of knowledge-seeking and compassion that motivated the soul to manifest as a human body, a personality. So those who have studied the near-death experience know that the two reasons for embodiment have to do with learning, with growing in our in knowledge and our love, ability to love. And that's really the meaning of the purpose of life, or of our being. The soul, I think I'm going to joke about that later, but yeah, the soul, or the consciousness that creates us, can have no motivations that pertain to the yet-to-be-created body, plus personality. Souls do not compete with one another, since, as any year's report, they experience directly their interconnections with all other souls, so as to constitute a single one mind. To reverse the old joke, no one has ever been told by the being of life that the reason they have to go back to their body is to make more money or gain more status. And the old joke is no one on their deathbed has ever regretted not spending more time at the office. All the regrets are with the personal relationship. Okay. So, on the contrary, any years tell us that the reasons for which they are sent back all fall under the headings of knowledge and love. And many studies show that the most profound after effect of the NDE is that greed and status seeking fall away from the personality replaced by knowledge seeking and compassion as motivators. This is an empirical fact. With statistics, right? Not necessarily in every case, but statistically. Yes, yeah, so you can psychologists know how to measure this. I refer to the work of people like Bruce Grayson and Ken Ray and many other investigators. On the contrary, and the love and knowledge of medicine, greed and status seeking fall away from the personality replaced by knowledge seeking and compassion as motivators. We know it's precisely this, that our greed-based status seeking material social order is the opposite of the values of love, compassion, and knowledge that experience while out of body that causes them in years so much stress upon return. The question we are asking might be put as follows: What might a social order look like that would be in harmony with what end years experience? A social order based on knowledge and love. well, it might be objective that a social order based on knowledge and love is impossible because humans, like other animals, are by nature greedy and competitive.
Yes.
The only thing humans are by nature is mortal. We're all going to die. That's the only thing we are by nature. Cooperation is as easily observed among animals as competition, and a newborn human is infinitely malleable by its culture. Those in whom selfishness and status seeking reign tend to believe that everyone else is just like them and have constructed ideologies according to which their own status seeking and greed-based behavior are just what Darwin's survival of the fittest demand. In fact, you remember the last election, Romney saying that the 47% are envious of the wealthy. And I don't think that's true at all, that many people are motivated differently. There are many people with loving kindness in their hearts, frustrated by lack of opportunities to express and grow that. Okay, but this is untrue. There are, to be sure, plenty of individuals who dedicate their lives to the pursuit of status and wealth, but it is also true that there are individuals who, despite being raised in the culture that idolizes greed and ambition, are nevertheless kind and altruistic. What might a social order look like that selects the latter human motivations instead of the former? Okay, so you imagine a newborn baby, and the society kind of was motivated in many different directions, from greed and ambition on one hand to caring for others and altruism. What would a social order look like? What would that baby become if you grew up in a social order that stressed and selected for the qualities of kindness, and love, and gentleness, rather than competition, winning, being right, acquiring status? Thus far, my argument has been mostly conceptual. From the fact that consciousness is not produced by the brain, it follows that the particular form of consciousness that we experience ourselves, our very self, is caused not by matter, nor by itself, but by another form of consciousness. This creating form of consciousness, which I refer to as the soul, has the usual characteristics associated with consciousness. Awareness, meaning, intent, intelligence, joy, love. That's what many years come back and tell us. You also get that from the mystic traditions all over the world. I then argue that because the soul is not material, its motivation or purpose in creating or manifesting as the human form cannot possibly have anything to do with material acquisition, except what is necessary to keep the body working properly. To the extent, therefore, that a soul, upon becoming human, becomes obsessed with thoughts of material acquisition, it has deviated from its original purpose. Human. A social order that is in harmony with the fact that consciousness is not created by the body, a post-materialist social order will have no place for greed and ambition. These will be looked at as forms of, well, as Spinoza says, species of madness needing to be cured and treated. Less strongly established by empirical data, but established nonetheless, is panentheism, which holds that individual souls are not atomic units of consciousness that exist independently of one another, but instead are perhaps like droplets of water condensing from a common source. Western religions, except for the mystical components, are deeply atomistic in nature, denying that all minds are intrinsically connected so as to form a single one mind, which is a panentheistic hypothesis. But even in religion, you can find it. So Spinoza quotes St. Paul approvingly. In him, capital H, I live and move and have my being. Right? You that past. So that's a clear statement of panentheism. In him, in God, I live and move, I have my being internal to the divine being. Okay? So that's a view that the church did not follow, obviously. If it is the case that all individual minds taken together constitute a single one mind, then the golden rules of all will consequence. Why treat someone else the way you would want to be treated? Because you're all part of a single being, right? And you're all one. In the deeper mystical and near-death experiences, one experiences oneself as the manifesting consciousness that manifests not only as his or her unique human form, but also as the form of all other beings. All manifest forms are as important and as divine as one's own, and any attitude other than one of loving kindness towards all created forms is inconsistent with panentheism and the experience of deeper connectedness. A social order based on the golden rule is the only kind of society consistent with our emergent post-materialist science. It is the only kind of, it is also the only kind of social order that at this present time will allow consciousness to continue manifesting in human form. So the earth has reached its limit with respect to the amount of greed it can support. And if humanity continues along the materialist path of greed and status again, the planet will no longer be able to support human life. Materialism at present has zero survival value. And then a footnote. Everyone knows that the current course of human behavior is unsustainable and suicidal. But no one seems to trace the causes to the materialist ideology permeating all aspects of present culture, but least of all, the materials themselves. So post-materialist philosophy, if it is to be worth anything, must, like post-materialist science, be in harmony with empirical data. Let's take a look at some of the data that favors the pantheistic worldview. Traditional theism holds that God creates us ex nihilo, out of nothing. So we are created separate from God. Panentheism holds that God creates us ex deus, out of himself. Well, perhaps we should leave the word God out of this and refer instead to the consciousness that creates us. So quite literally, our individual minds are part of the mind of the creating consciousness itself. A few well-chosen folks from deep near-death experiences make this point very well. I'm not sure how much close, but I'll read a few because I think it's important. So all these quotes are from Ken Ring's wonderful book, Lessons from the Light. We are aspects of the one perfect whole and as such a part of God and of each other. Second. And it became very clear to me that all the higher selves are connected as one being. All humans are connected as one being. We are actually the same being, different aspects of the same being. I realize that the entire universe is alive and infused with consciousness. Everything belongs to an invisible, to an infinite whole. We are all facets of that being. We're all one. In my NDE experience, I became the source. I existed in everything and it all existed within me. I became eternal and infinite. It would be difficult to find a clearer statement of panentheism if you're not close. But again, I'm taking this as empirical data, not as near religious beliefs, but as data. I argued above that because we are created by consciousness, there's meaning and purpose for our lives, and this meaning and purpose can have nothing to do with material acquisition. The following expresses this very concisely. Well, God told me there were only two things that we could bring back with us when we die, love and knowledge. So I was to learn as much about both as possible. And this is more or less the universal testimony of any years. There's a purpose in being human, a purpose that has nothing to do with material acquisition and status seeking, and everything to do with growing our ability to love and understand. A post-materialist social order will have to be in harmony with these values. Children will be raised according to these values rather than the values of greed and self-aggrandizement. Needless to say, capitalism will have to go the way of feudalism, monarchy, slavery, and other social orders that have outlived their usefulness. So Ken Ring is among the few scientists with the courage to highlight the moral large-scale implications of the NDE. The golden rule, he concludes, is not a mere, quote, precept for moral action, unquote. Rather, the golden rule, quote, is actually the way it works. If these accounts, in fact, reveal to us what we experience at the point of death, then what we have done to ourselves is experienced as, what we have done unto others is experienced as done unto ourselves. Let's take a look at a few accounts that lead to this conclusion. And here I have a page and a half of accounts. I think I'll skip some, but I'll read one or two just so you get a sense of the flavor. So this is the life review. And talk expert for us a little bit. So the life review, there are really three components. There's a first person, a third person component. You're sitting there watching it on the screen. First person component. You're going through every thought, every feeling. You're re-experiencing every single thing again. All this is happening instantaneous. And there's a third component, which is the second person perspective. You feel what's happening to yourself, the effects of all your interactions with every person that you've ever had. So if you hurt someone, you experience their hurt as happening to you. This is what the data suggests. Okay? I'll do some of the shorter ones. It showed me not only what I had done, but even how what I had done had affected other people, because I could feel those things. Not even your thoughts are lost. Everything is there. All of a sudden, my life passed before me. What occurred was every emotion I had felt in my life, I felt. What my life had done so far to affect other people's lives, using the feeling of pure love that was surrounding me as the point of comparison. Now, this seems to be common in near-death experiences. What they report is the unconditional, visceral love coming from being of light. And in that love, they see the light before them. And the love that they are then feeling, right, becomes the standard by which they judge their own life. There's no external judgment, it's all internal. And it comes to how much of this divine love that I'm now experiencing without deserving it, how much of it that I radiated into the world while I was alive. Okay, a little scary. And this guy says so. He says, what my life had done so far to affect other people's lives, using the feeling of pure love that was surrounding me as a point of comparison. And I had done a terrible job, God, I mean it, looking at yourself from the point of how much love you spread to other people is devastating. The short one, it was an opportunity to see and feel all the love I had shared, and more importantly, all the pain I had caused. I was able to simultaneously re-experience not only my own feelings and thoughts, but those of all the other people I had interacted with. Seeing myself through their eyes was a humbling experience. Okay, I'm going to skip the rest. As I mentioned before, one or two such accounts may be dismissed as anecdotes. That's a good one. Oh, just an anecdote. But when such accounts are multiplied a hundredfold, a thousandfold, 10,000-fold, and more, when they are invariant across widely divergent cultures, then they constitute data that must be taken seriously. It is quite obvious that our present capital social order is deeply consistent with this data. Now, the details of what a post-materialist social order might look like are, of course, beyond the scope of this paper. They are beyond the scope of any paper that could be written at this time. But following Plato, we can say this much now, and this is Plato's point in the Republic. In our new society, spiritual wisdom on the one hand and political economic power on the other must coalesce in the same individuals. Who, we might ask, shall we put in charge of governing and managing the wealth and finances of our society? Playfully assuming for the moment that the decision is up. Should it be people who are very wealthy? Should it be people who are very popular? Or should it be perhaps people with advanced degrees from Harvard Business Schools? Our present disastrous social order shows quite clearly that none of the above provides the requisite skills for governing. What qualifications then must an individual have in order to govern properly? Must develop the point by analogy in the manner of Plato. Every area of human endeavor recognizes that there is special knowledge, talent, training, and skills relevant to that specific area. Whether we consider art, music, and sports, or science, medicine, and engineering, or carpentry, plumbing, and cooking, we recognize that each area requires talent, education, skills, and much training before anyone can be considered as proficient in that area. Why, asked Plato 2,400 years ago, do we make an exception for politics and economics? Why do we as a society collectively behave as if money-making and status-seeking ambition were the only or best qualifications required of those who seek political and economic power? If we could step back from our current situation, capitalism a little bit, is it not insane for society to trust its economic well-being to those among us who are most greedy? Is it not equally insane to give political power to those who are most ambitious? Since when have greed and ambition been demonstrated to produce individuals who are fit to be the guardians, Plato's term, of the collective wealth of society? Clearly, from any sane perspective, allowing individuals who are mentally ill, as Spinoza would say, who are suffering from the madness of greed and ambition to rule, is like putting a fox in charge of the panels. This experiment has been done, and the results are absolute disaster. Allowing greed and ambition to rule and control the wealth of the earth is leading directly and unambiguously to the destruction of the earth's ability to support human life. And nothing could be more disastrous, conceivably more disastrous for humanity than their own extinction. I know that economists and other apologists for our current system will rave about the importance of a profit motive, without which they believe no one would do anything. But their arguments must not be seen as hollow for two main reasons. So the profit motive, a consequence of materialism, is leading to the destruction of the human race. So if you want to survive, you have to give up that motive. But just as importantly, the major premise of economists, that the profit motive is necessary to motivate people to get off their butts, so to speak, is empirically false. Right? What it believes, unless you're going to make a profit or something, you won't be motivated to do it. But that's absolutely false. Most people, even those who have not had an NDE, are not motivated by the desire to profit over others. They, or rather we, are motivated by desires such as curiosity, you want to know, kindness, helping others, and developing and expressing our talents and abilities. These, I said, are the real motivators of human behavior. Only individuals who are already somewhat mentally ill will fall for all this profit over nonsense. And those who have had a deep NDE know something about it that is important for us to learn. In the context of the life review, we experience the other as ourself. As Ken Ring has clearly shown, this is not merely some vague empathy for the other, but an experience of actual identity with the other. The profit motive instructs us to seek advantage over the other. But since the other is experienced as our very self, in your death experience, the profit motive becomes a logical impossibility, since there is no other, and it is logically impossible to gain advantage over oneself. The profit motive is thus formally consistent with the life review, because in the latter, there is no other over whom one can profit. So we know that capitalism will very soon come to an end, either by destroying the rest of the capacity for life, or by being replaced by an economic political system that will allow the planet to. Since I am not an optimist, I should consider the second option. I'm actually not an optimist all the time. sometimes I get depressed. But today I'm an optimist. We are seeking, so I told you to put a chart on our social life, who shall be the guardians of our society. That was quite small in the Republic. Since I am an optimist, I should consider the second option. We are seeking for someone, or ones who will conduct and manage the affairs of our society. What is the appropriate qualification for the job of leadership? What is the education, the training required in order to trust an individual with such awesome responsibility? I think that perhaps at long last, the world is ready to seriously consider Plato's answer to this question. Is it not now obvious? Clearly, the individuals we put in charge of managing our economy, governing our society, must be free from greed and ambition, and must, quote, desire nothing for themselves if they do not also desire for others, unquote. That's the quote of Spinoza. The individuals in charge of society must be those who do not desire for themselves anything that they do not also desire for others. Where might we find such individuals? And here I said, read again the above quotes that I just read, but I won't read again. In which NDEers describe themselves as being every person with whom they interact, being identical with every person with whom they interact. Could one who has had such an experience ever misuse political or economic power? Clearly not. Plato might say, did say, that one who is to become a ruler must first have caught a vision of the form of the good. That's his allegory for Plato. Right? A vision of the form of the good. We don't need to get stuck on words, because equivalently we might say that the most important qualification for becoming a leader is that one has experienced directly the interconnection of all beings. Or what is the same thing, that one has experienced directly the knowledge of the union between his own mind and the one mind that has created both himself and all other minds. This is the knowledge of mystics and deep near-death experiences, and only such knowledge removes all temptation to abuse power and authority. And this is really the point of Plato's Republic. So I'm going to take a few things out of understanding of Plato. As Plato puts it, this is a quote from Plato, Until philosophers rule as kings, or those who are now called kings and leaders generally and adequately philosophize, that is, until political power and philosophy entirely coincide, cities will have no rest from evil, nor, I think, for the human race. The passage is well known. People here have heard it on the record before the Plato's concept of the philosopher king. But Plato's concept of the philosopher king is not well understood, especially by academic philosophers. The word philosopher, as Plato uses it, has nothing to do with those who are called by that name in academic institutions. This is a serious charge. The word philosopher, as Plato uses it, defines it, has absolutely nothing to do with those who are called by that name in academic institutions. For Plato, a philosopher is a lover of wisdom, and wisdom is the state of consciousness enjoyed by the gods. That is, the state of consciousness that does not involve the body. Plato is very explicit about this. Comparing experiences of the embodied soul, personality, with the non-embodied soul, he states, when the soul makes use of the body to investigate something, as physical body, be it through hearing or seeing or some other sense, it is dragged by the body to the things that are never the same, not physical things, and the soul itself strays and is confused and dizzy. Anyway, just being embodied causes the soul to become drunk. But when the soul investigates by itself, that is, without the body, it passes into the realm of what is pure, ever-existing, immortal and unchanging, and being akin to this, yet the soul always stays with it, the eternal, whenever it is by itself and can do so. Then the soul rests from its wanderings in the physical realm and dwells with it, the eternal, unchangingly. For it, the soul, is dealing with what is unchanging, and its experience then is what is called wisdom. So the soul's experience in the unembodied state, that's what's called wisdom, what he calls wisdom. Notice that for Plato, the word wisdom refers to the soul's experience when released from its association with the body. And the philosopher then is one who desires for himself this state of consciousness, is a seeker of this state of consciousness. So that's what the word philosophy means, a seeker of, was a lover of wisdom, but he defines love and supposing as a seeking, a desire of something. Now, the majority of academic philosophers today are materialist atheists who believe that consciousness is entirely produced by the physical brain. Hence, they most definitely do not seek for themselves a state of consciousness that they believe does not exist. There's no such thing as non-embodied consciousness from materialist atheists type, and hence for the great majority of academic philosophers. Or people who are called philosophers. But mystics and NDEers would count as philosophers for Plato. They have been outside the cave, referring to the outer world of the cave, and have experienced the real and are ever seeking to align their human consciousness experience with what lies beyond the shadows of the cave. NDEers understand what Plato means when he refers to embodied consciousness compared with the heightened reality of non-embodied consciousness as wandering around, confused and dizzy, as if drunk. It is to such an individuals, and only to such individuals, that a sane society will trust its politics and economics. But the empirical data show quite clearly that the experience of being absorbed into the light, the unconditional thereof, removes the motivations of greed and ambition from the mind of the experience. Well, maybe not completely removes in all cases, but greatly lessens. And so there's plenty of empirical studies that support that. Until now, such spiritual knowledge has been quite rare, available only to some spiritual teachers in advanced months. But today, many individuals have had spiritually transformative experience. And I bet there are some people here in this room that had such experiences, which is why I come to these kinds of talks. And as medical technology continues to advance, many more will be brought back from so-called death and will have experience of consciousness per se, uncovered by God. So there will be no shortage of individuals who, because they themselves have seen and become the light of the created consciousness, are now qualified to have positions of leadership in our post-materialist world. How might all this come about? for it is quite unlikely that those who currently hold economic and political power will themselves become lovers of wisdom. Now, Plato himself got into trouble with this. That's for another. Indeed, greed and status seeking are addictions. They're addictions in that the more one has of these things, the more one needs in order to get the same high from acquiring. Which is why, brothers and capital, it's never enough. Most of us here, if we had a few hundred thousand in the bank, we'd be quite happy and we'd be giving it to our less fortunate friends. But for people who are insane, and I try to have a passion for them because it is an illness. It is an illness. It's never enough. It's never enough. No matter how much money they make, it's never enough. And they're always miserable. So the more one has of these things, the more one needs in order to get the same high from acquiring. They are no more able to relinquish their addiction to money making than an alcoholic can relinquish his craving for drink. Neither should we hold our collective breath, waiting for our universities, professional organizations, and other institutions of research to announce that science has established a reality of spirit, and henceforth we should all start loving one another. Wouldn't have been nice in Princeton.
Yeah, if yours had said to you and Robert, you've shown now that consciousness is an independent matter, now we should go become more spiritual, meditate.
No, they can't do it. Because for our universities as institutions for our culture, necessarily reflect and transmit the values of the culture's materialist paradigm. Our universities have done and are doing whatever they can to impede this research rather than promote it. And if you don't believe me, just talk to Brendan Robert, and you can talk to people at the University of Virginia who are also doing work with this, that's Stevenson and Tucker and Grayson. Nevertheless, through the media, the results of our research are reaching a much wider audience. For example, when the details of the life review become common knowledge, people will know that it is impossible to gain advantage by harming others, and greed and ambition, which necessarily harms others, will fall away. Those of us who are students of the near-death experience will doubtless have already noticed this within ourselves. Henry makes the point that just reading the near-death experience in depth can give you some of the changes that occur for people who have the experience. He used to teach a whole course at the University of Connecticut of the near-death experience, and he would do before the course and after the course, measurements of the, I don't know, psychological fear of death index or something like that. He was a psychologist and he wanted to do these. And he would show that just reading about the near-death experience induces real changes in the students, in their attitude. Okay, almost done. One of Plato's major themes is that the outer social order mirrors the inner psychological order, and vice versa. A just individual is one who is ruled by her higher emotions and desires. A just society is one that is ruled by the most morally developed of human beings. As individuals, we have the power to move things along, so to speak, by looking within. Examining our own emotions and desires, and identifying those of our own desires that fall into the general patterns of greed and ambition. If, for example, we notice that we are seeking status and desire to get ahead of others, then we might reflect that those others who wish to get ahead of will feel hurt, as we would feel if someone got ahead of us. So the desire to get ahead necessarily involves hurting others. And as Rin has emphasized, it is in the nature of things that in the life review, we will experience ourselves as the others, and hence feel the hurt and cause. These and similar reflections may be sufficient to relinquish getting ahead as a motivation. This is something like it, I think, is what Socrates must have meant at his trial when he stated, the unexamined life is not worth living. I think Socrates' injunction will be satisfied if, while contemplating any course of action, we ask ourselves, how will this play out in my life review? I'm going to be happy with that in my life review. And if enough individuals examine themselves in this way and change their inner life accordingly and talk about it with others, the outer social reality will follow suit. That's my quote. And there's a footnote here. This might be the most important thing that I said. Talk about it with others. Those who've had a spiritually transformative experience need to talk about it with others.
So this point is important. There are powerful taboos in our material society against discussing such experiences with others. Right? Some years back, you talked about a near-death experience when you post-surgical, they sent it to the psych ward. Our recent cultural experience that culminated in legalizing gay marriage came about largely because gay people increasingly came out of the closet at some cost to them, some pain to them, rejection in religious circles, going to hell, and all that. But they came out of the closet. At some point, every straight person realized that they had friends and family members who were gay. I think that's, you know, it caught me completely by surprise. If you'd asked me a year before it became legal, I was not aware a generation away from that. The spiritual closet, I think, is even larger than the gay closet. So there's some estimate that 10% of the population is gay. And I think more than that, 10% of the population have had spiritually transformative experiences, or just weird stuff happening. You told me about, you know, psychic stuff that you just can't explain. So the spiritual closet is perhaps even larger than the gay closet was. So if enough people have had spiritually transformative experiences, dropped their fear of ridicule, and came out of the closet to friends and family, then everyone will realize that they personally know someone who has had such an experience. At this point, perhaps, it will become acceptable to talk openly about such experiences in our culture, and our culture will necessarily change as a result. So that's my goal. Thank you.
Discussion. I emphasize discussion. I don't see myself as an expert or someone who can answer questions or anything. So, discussion is what's needed. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. That's
good. Okay. Okay. So, and just
I'm going to go to the next one. Thank you. I'm I'm
I'm going to put my two cents in, and then I'm going to try to be quiet. I was commenting to Neal that, to me, the two most important, or two of the most important implications of a post-materialist social order would be the reduction in teen suicide and the reduction in depression. And think what that would do to the pharmaceutical companies. Neal, why don't you take it, and please feel free to speak up.
So you see that point, makes the point that there are powerful vested interests in basically hiding the results of this research.
What's happening there?
Right? That's right. And if you want to see resistance, you can even go back to William James, who complains about the same thing. He hounded at Harvard for his, he spent meetings.
Flights,
and concluded that there was nothing to it.
In my experience and memory, I've never had an NDE. I hope that's not a prerequisite for the wisdom that you have described, which I do identify with. I'm wondering about measuring wisdom and other ways of achieving it other than.
Did everyone hear the question?
I'm wondering about measuring and the measuring wisdom and other ways of acquiring it other than having an NDE myself.
I have an answer. So one of the leading researchers on near-death experience in our country is Bruce Grayson, a psychiatrist, Virginia people. And he's not written a book, but he's written many, many articles and given many, many talks. And someone asked him, I think it was it's a similar question. It's like, so he's a psychiatrist and he's talking to the medical world. And acknowledging there really are such things as wacky hallucinations and psychotic episodes. And, you know, where one dissociates from reality in a very confused way. And how do you tell the difference between a psychotic episode or schizophrenic and somebody who's really nuts and somebody who's had a near-death experience? And you know what he did? This was in a professional article to psychiatrists. He quotes Jesus. He says, by their fruits, you shall know them. Right? Are they kind? Are they more helping with others? Are they more at peace within themselves? Are they more energized for making this a world a better place? More kind and loving in their relationships with others, okay, then it's something real. Are they whacked out? Are they buying guns? Are they, you know? I had a friend who came to the meeting, and I knew her before in the act, she started hearing it in her voice. And she was a recovering Catholic and doing volunteer work at a psychiatric hospital, and she felt between a rock and a hard place, right? On the one hand, hearing voices means you're nuts, on the other hand, hearing voices means the devil's coming at you. And she finally realized that what to help discern that is what the voices are saying. If the voices are telling you to go kill people, right, in the name of God, probably you might not want to listen. But if they're helping you, giving you messages of kindness for other people, messages that other people think that's fairly accurate and helpful, then it's a voice you can listen to. I like that because the responsibility of discernment is ours. It's ours.
It's been my experience and with other people that the good guys, the good voices, or messages have a tendency to give you choice. They never impose.
Yes.
They give you the option to accept or not. And the bad voices never do. So.
And Plato himself makes a distinction between two kinds of madness. He says, this madness brought about by moral maladies, and madness that comes as inspiration from the gods. And the phrase, a divine madness, is Plato's. Right? And he gives us an example. The true artist, the creative artist, right? And the medium, and the lover. The person who's madly crazy in love with you, right, is that madness, he says, is inspired by the gods. Well, that's in the Phaedrus.
My question is, have you thought anything about Bill Gates? Because it seems to me, I don't know. You tell me, I don't know. Because does he go from greed to altruism? I mean, it looks like that, but what happened?
Okay, so when I say that rich people are greedy, obviously, that's a statistical statement. It's not to be understood categorically.
Doesn't predict you're greedy to do.
No, not at all. There are poor people who are totally aligned in their thinking with rich people. They're only complaining that it's not they themselves who are rich. But they are just as greedy, right, as the confidence in their hearts.
That's what's the old question.
It's so easy, you know, when you speak with the call of the front.
I was just thinking in response to the question that this gentleman asked. I don't know if you can hear it. I was just thinking in response to what this gentleman was talking or asked. Do you need a near-death experience to have this kind of mentality and thinking? And thinking about what you had said, just reading about others' experiences kind of plants that seed that it's possible. Because I've never had a near-death experience, but I've read many, you know, books, you know, based on the subject.
I believe that there are many people, if not most people, whose feeling, you know, emotional sense is already aligned with the values of the near-death experience. But I think we know greatest happiness comes from the beginning that we learned something, that we helped another, that we made a difference to someone or to some group. I think most people are like that. But it's just that 1% or 1/10 of 1% that are really insane and that basically controlling the political economic dynamics. Most people, I believe, are naturally in harmony with the values of the near-death experience, but we feel much depression, anger, confusion, that our society does not allow us to express these values. We're thrust into a competitive world. You've got to pay your rent, you've got to feed your kids. Right? So you go for job positions, you know, you look for security, material wherewithal to do it, and it's very soul destroying. And we suffer from depression, neuroses, anxieties as a result. I think.
Neal, thank you. I'm totally with you. Just to begin with, just to make clear, because I would like to offer it's not criticism, but you know, along the lines of devil's advocate, because as you know perfectly well, that chain of reasoning is not stronger than the weakest joint of it. So, I just want to point out some difficult links in what you said for me, which as a sound, and you may either respond or maybe later you would. because I really wanted to be make for you, for us, to make a strong argument, because the major point is really very much needed, namely that the truth that I am the other, or I am, which we all know from empathy, from elementary empathy, that that sense, we don't need me in this experience, really, if we ever. But to point out that this difficult point, first of all, your connection with the very beginning of materialism as a metaphysical position and materialistic way of life. It's, well, you see, when you're talking of, first of all, along the lines of materialistic but metaphysical position, if you recall the Stoics, they had a very subtle, matter can be very subtle, it can be like they talk of spiritual pneumatic bodies, which for them are material, because but it's a subtle matter. And if you talk of status, status is not something one can grab, it's a matter of pride. So the real, I would say, underlying presupposition of this state of the world is awful. State of the world. It's, in my view, not so much materialistic metaphysics, but spiritual atomism, which you, namely, the idea. So when you conflate the two, you make, in my view, the stronger part more vulnerable because of this connection with, in my view, logically weaker part. Because the status that Greek are for status. It's not meat, it's not like some, but it depends on spiritual atomism. So, okay, but then if you did that, because I'm not finished.
So I think, you know, status and reputation, I believe you're claiming that status and reputation are in fact not something you can squeeze in your hands, that can't be measured. I disagree. Every department and every university knows the status of every member of the profession, measured by a number of papers, reputations, invitations to talk at lectures. So I think status and reputation are measurable, and among the material things that one can measure. Say I achieve this status. But I can't tell you how much I love my grandchildren. There's no measure of that. You see, I can't say anything about how to measure it. The only kindness that I desire to radiate. Or when someone, even a stranger, just smiles at me and says, hello, good morning. I can't measure the effect that that has on me. But reputation and status are, I think, material. And I think there's something that you can squeeze. There's anything you can put a measure on that you can measure. That's materials, I think. So I want to start, we can talk about that.
I just wanted to ask, you know, human beings from the beginning, you know, we're talking about cavemen. Maybe one guy felt like he had a nicer cave than the other guy, or a bigger club. So to me, it almost seems like it's something that every human being is created with back to the beginning of humans. So I'm wondering, it seems like the way society has become, it's almost the materialism and the avarice and the greed and everything is something that needs to be thrown off like a yoke, but it never is. It was always there.
I'm not sure.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah.
So what happens to that?
Yeah. I heard I was an anthropologist and study other.
Right.
And in indigenous cultures, when they kill an animal, whoever kills it, they share it with the whole tribe. Right? And indigenous cultures, it's never the case that one person measures his self-worth by how much he can afford. Right? But everything is shared, and his reputation, his status in the tribe, depends on how much he can contribute to the well-being. Of the tribe. And
Wouldn't that make him a more valued person in the society, in which case he would gain status automatically, even though he may not have been trying to achieve it?
But
so I'm hoping that it happens.
The status is, I guess, also status. But, you know, just like if you're a creative artist, then your creativity gets recognized. So you have more status than somebody who's a mechanical artist. But it's what you get status for.
It's unavoidable, is what I'm saying, Harry. Right? Wouldn't you say?
No, but status is not only necessary. You started out with creative status is real.
Well, no, I didn't mean to do that. I didn't mean to equate anything.
And I think indigenous cultures, you might use the word esteem rather than status.
Okay, there you go. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But there's a culture, I forget where, Australia or New Zealand or somewhere, where everyone is held in esteem for their quality. So you might have the quality of sweeping up the campsite.
They're recognized for their capabilities.
Exactly. Right. So nobody is better than the other. Everybody is equal in status, but they make different contributions.
Okay. Actually, that's the way to look at it.
This is the point.
It's a way that it should be or could be or strive for.
I think a lot of indigenous cultures
are that way.
I think status based on greed, accumulation, and money, I think that's a Western thing.
Well, I agree with that. Yeah.
So I let you start out saying.
Well, you cleared that up for me. Yeah, you're right. What I was positing is it's something that's innately in all humans, probably not.
Let me make just as.
It seems to be predominant in a lot of societies, so unfortunately. Yeah, Western society.
So Anita Bajani, have you heard of her? I recommend her quote, Dying to Live.
Yeah.
She had a very deep near-death experience, and she's a very eloquent public speaker. She compares reality to a tapestry, to a big tapestry, and each individual is a thread in that tapestry. Each thread is different from each other thread, but each thread is absolutely necessary and essential for the tapestry as a whole. So if we model our social order after that metaphor, right, that everyone is esteemed automatically just by your own existing. Why are you worthy? Why should you be esteemed? Because you exist. Not because of anything you've done. And again, they talk about unconditional love. A lot of people don't understand what that means and have experienced it. But it does imply that unconditional love is not conditional on anything that you've done. Anything. Right?
Yeah.
And that's why a lot of people feel unworthy. Use that as a basis to judge their own mind. But this sense of that the whole of which we are, the fabric, the tapestry as a whole, of which we are individual threads. Loves us unconditionally, period. Because it created us ultimately. And we may not know what our role is or how we plan a part of the tapestry of the whole, but having a metaphor like that for going through life is, I think, a lot saner than for all these individuals, you know, competing with God and God and world, or life's a bitch and then you're dead. You know, these things are such. No, we all belong to a whole.
Well, it's a more encouraging way to look at life.
Yeah.
For certain.
Yeah. And we all have a heart, and everyone is equally valuable. Because even the tiniest of thread, you take it away, and the tapestry could be.
Neal, what would you say the origin of greed? You talked about that today as a really important point. Why are we greedy?
Can I leave that to future psychologists? I think the answer is, this may not be just one answer to this. And I'd like to say, the human mind can raise many questions that it cannot answer, that the intellect, right? But people in their death experience say, all my questions were answered. But why is it evil? Why does God permit, blah, 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 to exist? They all get, but they're answered in that
our body state in which things are realer than real. But I have a responsibility to God.
So if you were out of body, what would the answer be?
You wouldn't use words.
Yes.
And this is so much now on the, but there's always been, so I've been playing on the limitation of words. The Sufi mystic Rumi, there's a quote from him, which I can't find anymore, but it went like, language is like a tailor shop in which nothing fits.
Just a quick throw out, I think one of the motivations for greed is probably a lack of self-worth, and you're trying to find, put some value on yourself because you don't feel you're valuable. But I am brought to mind something that was written by a very dear friend of mine who's into Plato and Socrates and happens to be here, in which he pointed out that perhaps the original sin that creates these insecurities and such and some primordial guilt is that we have forgotten that we are spiritual creatures. And we've separated ourselves from the spiritual realm, and we're hiding from that, and we're feeling guilty about it. And so we cover it up with the need for stuff.
Guilty.
I may be misrepresenting.
You know, we're in these bodies, and these bodies are you know, can die, and there are many threats to it, many ways it can. And when we identify very strongly with the body and think that that's what we are this body, we become very fearful of all the many multifaceted threats throughout the continued existence of this body. And so we hoard, we do this, and the more fearful we are, it's never enough, right? Because no matter how much money we have, we're still mortal, right? And there's still threats to the body, right? So I think maybe greed, one of the contributing factors to greed is this this fear of that my body is not safe, and no matter what I do, maybe I cannot guarantee the safety of the body.
I would rather say I would use the word empty. That some people are empty, and they can never be filled up. There's never enough.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's because of a lack of connection. So this is vertical level, right? And it's horizontal level, and that what Eckhart Tolle talks about this. And you try to fill up that hole on the horizontal level with stuff, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. You try to fill it though with deepening a sense of connectivity to the task in which we are.
Right. I was just thinking that you're talking that greed is something that we have until we get mature enough to realize that this isn't our real existence, like we're actually connected to anything. That immaturity starts because human beings are generally born at a very young age. Human beings are generally born at a very young age. And it takes them a while for to remember, so everybody starts out with that need, which can be developed easily into that greed, until you remember to not have that greed.
Yeah. But I think that some concern and fear of the body, continued survival, or it's maybe part of what we take on when we come in. Yet there's such a wide variety of differences among human beings. There are plenty of, that seems to be plenty of human beings who are born with very little of that fear, right? And they want to do good in the world, they're kind and compassionate, or they want to develop their own abilities, their own talents as much as they can, and they're not fearful for, you get tenure at a respectable university. That's a fear-based thing, right? And there are plenty of people like that. And then there are people who are just totally into fear, and to be honest, I have $1 million by the time I'm 30. People like that, they're business majors.
I've heard that people are operating out of two ends of the spectrum. There's fear and there's love, and you could be in either one of those or anywhere in between there. Do you think that our existence is coming from a biological nature, which is coming from evolution, which has put us to where we are in matter, but yet now this convergence of our matter with what we call the source of the one, little God, whatever you want to call it, is bringing that down and converging with us to be one? And maybe greed goes back to us having a side of us that is dealing with that more biological nature of the hunter-gatherer side, where it's fear-driven and we need to survive. So this whole survival thing is going on. So some people identify with that, and maybe other people are, I really don't need to live out of my biological mind, so to speak, but I have now learned to put myself more into my spiritual side and connecting more to the source and within my soul. So maybe as you learn more and you experience NDEs or you're reading or whatever, you're growing your knowledge, you're maturing and everything, and it helps to pull you out being so materialistic. So you know, everything's just about matter here, and it kind of makes you look at it at a different level. So do you think it's really those two sides that we're kind of roughly fighting with when we go in and out of those zones all the time between mind and between soul? And maybe it is again between fear and between love, what area you're operating in.
That's right. Something. Now, when I say something like it, that's almost a platonic way of speaking. Because Plato always says, you can't say in words what it is, but maybe you can say a little bit about what it is like. We certainly know that spiritual teachers tell us that the opposite of love is my hate is fear. Right? So those two are opposites. And that fear is a body. And love is the spirit, and we are both. And we are both. But to be genuinely happy in one, especially with one myself, one needs to align more with the love side. The fear side, to recognize the fear for what it is. How many know that here about the Course in Miracles? Okay, so you know the dedication page. You correct me if I get it wrong. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Therein lies the peace of God. So, the application of this, it took me years and years to sort of get it. When I feel the emotion of fear that maybe nobody's going to like this talk, but a little fear. Fear someone's disapproved, fear of monsters chasing me in nightmares, whatever. Whenever you feel fear, recognize that that's a sign that it's not real. Which is hard to do, because there's a real life chasing that. Or whatever, but that this life is sort of an illusion. You know the film crew, was it Roger Ebert, who died recently. And as he was dying, he was in and out. And he was a lifelong atheist, materialist atheist. And this is his wife on the recording. The last thing she said, it's all a hoax, an elaborate hoax. And of course, for him, it was a hoax because he was totally taken in. We know that those of us here that, yeah, it is, it's been compared as unreal, as an illusion, but nevertheless, an illusion that serves a purpose. And what near-death experiences tell us is that this purpose has something to do with growing in our ability to love one another, despite the other's behaviors, right? And in learning, knowledge. And knowledge doesn't necessarily need to be totally spiritual, although it implies that. Study the quantum theory, that's knowledge.
As you of course know, the earliest account of near-death experience in yes, at the end of Republic, in the story of Air. And my question is, as you of course know, but I just reminded the guy, he observes in this experience that the souls actually choose their next. So in other words, whoever is a business, whatever, greedy or status seeker, it's the soul that has chosen it. And this raises the question how to fit it metaphysically if all abstractions or kind of, darkenings come from the body, as it seems comes, as in Spinoza also, all emotion, greed is an emotion, right? It comes, but it looks like if a soul being, even before the body chooses it, how they explain it? Is there something there, kind of, in the world of, in the attribute of the thought itself, some darkness which kind of motivate the soul for choosing this coming, as I encounter, I have a personal person I know who had near-death experience, and it was revealed to him in this near-death experience that the reason he came into this role is was drug, sex, and drug. So what does it tell of the soul which is yet before the body, if it chooses this way? So
we probably have time for one more question.
Okay. So let me briefly respond to that, and then there's a question over here. Two things I want to say. So one is actually, if you go back and read it, yes, the soul chooses their future life. They see it all laid out in front of them and say, this is the one I want. But there are other factors, which he calls luck. Big one. And some kind of determinism, too, because the basis on which the wisdom with which a soul chooses its future life depends on how it has lived its previous life. So there are many, many factors that go into the, you know, why did this particular soul choose this particular life. But the thing I want to say is I used to be, and maybe it's still a little bit, interested in these metaphysical questions, but I come to believe that the human mind cannot figure it out conceptually. We're always going to go back and forth with it. It doesn't mean that trying to come up with a, you know, the right concept, is it Kant, is it Hegel, is it Whitehead? I appreciate very much him because he said all the history of philosophy is just a footnote to play. I think I am now personally more interested in, okay, what's my next step? I know I some individuals that I'm having trouble loving, and I know that it's my responsibility to work that through. And so my approach life and love with lightness and with humor, and to be able to be in the present moment as much as possible. Now this is something Eckhart is talking about, this present moment of consciousness. That's what spirituality is. If you notice that our body is always in the here and now. Mind is rarely in your mind. You're just walking down the street, you know, where's your mind? You're focused on something happening in the past or something you're going to do in the future. Right? But you're up in the here and now. And what Eckhart says, the portal to the divine is in the here and now. Your mind has got to become still in order to experience that. So I find when I get off on the metaphysical things, my mind is anything but still. It could be this, it could be that. Yet I do think it's good exercise. You know, just working out in the gym is good exercise for the body. But the important thing is how are you going to use the strength of the body in the world? You're going to use it to beat up on people weaker than you. The same thing with the intellect. Our universities are dominated by people with overdeveloped intellects, with very little heart and very little sense of how to use it wisely. So philosophy is my opinion, of you know, that has degenerated into ego-centered word games, semantics. And because of that, they need to ridicule these ideas and these concepts. Yeah.
It seems like the people that Plato considered to be good rulers, the philosopher kings, really seek out positions of power or want to go to them. Can you talk a little bit more about how we find that and convince them to be rulers?
I sent a copy of the paper to Ken Ray, because I quoted him so much. He wrote back saying, some of the near-death experiences that I know, there's no way I want to put them in charge of anything. So, having a near-death experience, but having being outside the cave might be a necessary but not sufficient condition in Plato's system. For him, the vision of the cave was something hard and wanted, required devoting your life to it, to study to the exclusivity of all else, and association with an enlightened person. Whereas a near-death experience happens to people just like that. There's no preparation for it. So many come back difficulty integrating it into the lives, but they're not automatically at the same level that Plato's philosopher king is at when they've gone outside and gave the cave vision of the one. The deep mystical experience reported in most of these religions seems to be deeper than the near-death experience. But the near-death experience itself has many, many levels, right? So at some point, I think this is a deep near-death experience, not just one where you just were outside your body and you witnessed the resuscitation, right? But if you did this, experience yourself as one with the being of life, that is not what I would call deep. Where you experience yourself as identical with what created you and what created all other souls. I think when we play with these ideas, I think we have to lose some of the concept. There are many, many conceptual ways of talking and understanding it. And I think all of us have some value. Now, for me, Spinoza attracted me very much because of his rigor. If you try to read the ethics, he starts from axioms and postulates, and it looks like he calls it the geometrical method. Yeah. You read Spinoza, he's all over the place. Right? With metaphor, allegory. Whenever Spinoza talks about the non-material world, he uses allegory, metaphor, similar figures of speech. And yet they are both basically very similar worldviews, but you have to see the worldview as something independent of the language and concepts that you used to talk about. You could say the same thing, you know, for Eastern philosophies, as well as for some of the newer things coming in, like the Course in Miracles, or the set material, and other stuff that's around. It's the similar teachings, but different ways of expressing it. And I would say, find a way of expressing it that sort of resonates with who you are, because we're all different. We all have different temperaments, different abilities, and different ways of resonating with the divine.
I just wanted to add something. The state of being one with that being of life that people experience in the near-death experience is the same state of enlightenment or nirvana that the mystics have been seeking for thousands and thousands of years, and it's why people meditate for 20 years. And it's the attempt to see God that every spiritual being, really a spiritual being, not just us, but you know, the people that are really dedicated, this is the experience that everybody wants. So this, you know, some people get lucky, so to speak, and die and are brought back and they can talk about it, but other people have to work for whole lifetimes to attempt to achieve it.
Yeah, and but I used to use the word they got lucky. I used to wish I had a near-death experience, but when you talk about near-death experiences, they go through a lot of physical pain, you know.
And a lot of emotional pain.
And a lot of emotional pain. Yeah, so I was talking with them just a few nights ago, so it's a little fresh and sharp in the, it's not as easy as the experience is itself a challenge for them to work with and integrate into their lives. We have permission from the chief of governors of the place to.
Thank you very much. My question is multi-tiered. The first one is in regard to conscious awareness, conscious awareness and mindfulness in regard to not just your intention and your being sensitive to the stimulus around you, whether it's energy or otherwise. But I'm someone who has had near-death experiences, but prior to that, I had other experiences that were interrelated to out-of-body experiences, but at night, usually when I was sleeping. So what I see is we have three basic emotional needs. Typically, through research, they're saying affection, achievement, attention, or acceptance by your peers. If we are mindful and keep the mind and body interconnected, through whether it's meditation or actually learning how to become centered, knowing yourself and your motivation, and again, being aware of the impact that we all have on society and around us, I think that is the key. And then looking at things with depth instead of linearly, which our educational programs, especially Western-wise, have limited the mind in our perceptions of what the reality is around us. So again, to be aware, and also my question to you though specifically is emotion and feeling thought. And if we looked at the brain more physiologically and worked with the physics of it, and the integration between, let's say, the neurons and the glia, and the fact that the glia actually alter the neurophysiology within the brain by thought, and it changes your neurochemistry. It also is sensitive to subatomic particles that are the electronic stimulus around you and harmonic resonance that's within the air that is at different levels, that if we are connected to those, we end up being able to perceive things that, again, hopefully we can create a more global awareness of society in doing such activities of becoming centered and mindful of what's happening around us. And has that been proven yet through research in regard to the glia, the neurons, consciousness, the mind, emotion?
Well, it just happens. Coincidence, no doubt. That the guy who's putting together this book, which is a chapter, is a neuroscientist. Mario Beauregard, and he's done research just on that. And it's called top-down causation, where one's intent actually alters the biochemistry of the brain. And I don't know if it was quantum mechanics, I could talk shop with him, but the neuroscience is beyond me. But he gives many, many examples. One of them is called Brain Wars. I'm not sure it's an appropriate title. But he just documents this case after case of top-down causation. The very familiar placebo effect being one such case. Right? Here's something right in front of us, right, that has no explanation in terms of materialist science. Right? So he points that out. But there's much more to it. It's just a great book to get the details. And if he goes into the brain and actually measures the chemicals, whatever, something between the cells. Yeah.
Yes.
So these things can be measured. How definitive these scores are, I don't know. He's very much on top of this.
It would be like dark matter.
Yeah.
Well, that part of physics, glia, is like dark matter.
Yeah, okay. So he has observed and then there's experiments with distant prayer, distant healing. Do you know Gene Atchenberg's work? Okay, so we have definite measurements in the brain of somebody, has something going on at the exact time that healers 5,000 miles away sending positive energy. So you do have plenty of empirical evidence for this topic. Again, those contrary to materialist reductionism, right? That is the whole built up out of atomic units, because here these atomic units are being structured by the whole in which they fit. This is what happened with quantum theory, right? The look for the search for the ultimate particles, molecules, atoms, protons, electrons, and then the quarks. Well, it turns out that the quarks do not exist, cannot exist independently of the whole of this molecular constant. So again, it's holism built into the foundation of the material world. Okay, that
here is time. You're such a great group, and I love these discussions. I really look forward to them. But unfortunately, we have room for a limited number of hours, and we have to start cleaning up. Now, you are all welcome to stay here until 5 p.m., which is about 35 minutes from now. And then we do kick you out. You're welcome to stay and chat with each other, talk to Neal, get him to sign his book for you, buy books, or whatever, talk to each other. But we do have to officially close so we can start closing shop. Thank you for coming. Please come back in January. And between now and our next meetup, I hope you all have a wonderful holiday season. And I, for one, as Thanksgiving approaches, am thankful for all of you and for the opportunity to be able to share these events with you and for your interest in them. We'll look forward to seeing you again.
Yeah, that's a little strange.